Hello learners, I welcome you all in yet another video lesson on course code 509 of D.El.Ed program of National Institute of Open Schooling. Today we are going to talk on unit 9, which is there on assessment in social science, and the today's topic is areas of learner assessment in social sciences. Before moving on the topic, let me discuss with you the proposed flow of the lesson. In the beginning, I would share with you the lesson guide. Then I am going to share with you the expectations in terms of learning objectives. Then we will discuss about the assessment, concept, nature and need. Then we will also discuss about the prominent practice or practices in assessment in social sciences. Then we are going to talk about the areas of learners' assessment in social science. Then we will recapitulate at the end, and then there would be a take home task. Now moving on the lesson guide, let me share with you the lesson guide. During my presentation, I will explain and exemplify the different concepts. You should follow my voice and the slides as well. You will find important words and sentences, etc., have been highlighted to facilitate retention. I have also summarized the main point at the end to have a quick glance for better retention. There are some questions or exercises in between, and at the end of my presentation, you are advised to attempt these questions or exercises after going through the video lesson. Now moving on the learning objectives or the expectations in terms of learning objectives. After going through this lesson, you would be able to get acquainted with the concept, nature and need of assessment in social sciences. Then you would be able to get information of the prominent or holistic practices of the assessment in social sciences. Then after going through this video lesson, you would be able to identify areas of learners' assessment in social sciences, which is the prime topic for this lesson. Now I need your help in a problem. I have a student whose name is Madhu. Madhu and her friends, who are 6th grade students, are wondering about their performance in school from the past few months. Could you tell that what may be missing in this case? What would be your answer? I think you would answer that they have not been assessed, or if assessed, their marks or their result or their performance scores have not been communicated to them. But before moving on the assessment or the problem of assessment, let me share with you or discuss with you the concept of assessment. So, as far as the learner's assessment is concerned, it is defined as the systematic process of documenting and using empirical data on the knowledge, skill, attitude, and belief to refine programs and improve students' learning. Mind it, educational assessment has a purpose. It is done to refine the program or our teaching and also to improve students' learning. Assessment is often interchangeably used with test, but it is not limited with test. It is more than that. It is a wider term. Now coming on the problem of assessment, when we talk about assessment, as happened in the case of Madhu, there are some questions associated with learners' assessment. These questions are: why should children be assessed? If we are talking about assessment or we are discussing assessment, one need to question then why the children should be assessed. Then what should be assessed? If we are talking about students' performance, then which aspect of students' performance should be assessed to be given weightage to their performance? Then when should the assessment be done? Then the next question is, how should the assessment be done? And then how can assessment information be utilized? So there are 5 questions which are associated with learner assessment, and if we are able to give response to these questions, we would be a better assessor of our students' performance, which may enhance their learning as well as make our teaching more effective and efficient in its nature. Now there is a scenario for you. First discuss a scenario with you. In a school, 40 children of a class 8th who appeared half yearly examination scored between 20 and 95 out of 100, the total marks. In social science, majority scored between 50 and 60, that's in range, average. Hari, who stood first, obtained 95 marks, whereas Geeta, who stood second, scored 91 in the social science. Geeta's mother managed to learn about the marks obtained by Hari in different subjects and compared with that of her daughter in the progress card. She found that Geeta has scored higher marks in rest of the subject and in aggregate as well. Geeta's total marks in the examination remained highest in the class. That's why Geeta scored first position in the class. However, Hari is first in terms of social science score. Despite all these, her mother did not express her satisfaction with the performance of Geeta. The reason being she scored less in social science, particularly than Hari, who happened to remain in second position in last many examination. She warned Geeta to see that Hari never exceed in any subject in the annual examination. Interestingly, her class teacher and Geeta's classmate also reacted to her marks in comparison to that of Hari in similar manner. Now, the question arises that does the evaluation or assessment which cause the feeling of insecurity, stress, anxiety and humiliation justified? Obviously not, as it brings out what the child does not know or cannot rather than what the child knows or can do. Aren't we doing filtration? I think yes. We must ask ourselves, what should we really assess? Should we assess what the child does not know or cannot do? Are there other ways of assessing children besides examination or paper pencil test, the most traditional way of assessing children? Is reporting in terms of marks enough or anything else is required? Should we encourage children to compete for more marks as Geeta is stressed upon to compete with Hari to get more marks in all the subjects in future by her mother, by her class teacher and also by the reaction of her own peers? Now, answering the questions, the five fundamental questions which are associated with the assessment, the first question is what to assess. To find out what learning and change is taking place, we need to assess. To find out or to identify the individual needs and requirements, we need to assess. To plan teaching learning processes in a more suitable manner, we need to assess. To help the child understand about what he or she knows and can do, we need to assess, we need to look at their performance, we need to dig upon that what they can do and where the problem is lying, where they need more and more effort to perform well. We need to assess for that. To find out the extent of achievement of objective, we need to assess. To improve teaching learning process, we need to assess. To communicate the children's progress to them, to the parents and associated stakeholder, we need to assess. To do away with the fear of assessment among children, we need to assess. To encourage and support children to learn together, we need to assess. Now, coming on the second question, what to assess? The ground has been set, why to assess? Now, we need to answer what to assess. Children's learning in subject areas is needed to be assessed in different subject areas such as history, geography, civics, economics and Hindi, English, languages, mathematics, sciences. We need to assess that how children are performing in different scholastic area, in different subjects area. We need to assess the children's skills, interest, attitudes and motivation because we are required to give them the direction for future. Thereby, we need to assess their skills, interests, attitudes and motivation. Children participation in social activities are also required to be assessed as The main objective of schooling is also the socialization of the children. Therefore, the participation in social activities is also required to be assessed. To ensure the level of requisite social skills to be instilled in the student. Children's response to different situations and or the opportunities both in and out of the school needs to be assessed. Children participation in co-scholastic or co-curricular activities need to be assessed, as assessment is an holistic activity. It cannot ignore any of the aspects of child performance. Therefore, all the aspects of child performance, all the aspects of his or her school life need to be assessed to look upon his progress and development in all the areas of his personality. Now coming on the third question, when to assess? The assessment should be continuous, that is, it should be formative in nature and also summative in nature. We need to look at our children continuously to gauge how they are progressing and what kind of heights they are attaining. So we need to assess them continuously. Continuous assessment implies maintaining a profile of each child. This is required to reflect upon, derive feedback, plan and implementation measures so as to enhance children's learning. Thus, continuous assessment implies a cycle of learning and assessment which moves on continuously again and again and again. Now, moving on, how to assess? What should be the mechanisms of assessment? There are sources through which we can obtain data on children performance. Those sources are children themselves, parents, child's friends or peers, classmates, community members, principal, headmaster, school records such as attendance record, attendance registers, so on and so forth. Then how to collect the data? Beside traditional method, that is paper and pencil test, recording observation in diary on daily basis, assessing the child's work during activity, writing descriptive statements on child's work, preparing a child's profile or portfolio of work, note of important changes could be the potential methods to collect data about child's performance or progress. Then the question comes, how the interpretation of this data or the data obtained could be done for future communication. Then we are having traditional methods in terms of scores which we usually use, and we are also having grades to communicate about the children performance to the different stakeholders. Now coming on under the method of assessment, there are some innovative ways of assessment which is continuous and comprehensive evaluation. It is a popular term through which the students or the learners are supposed to be evaluated during their school life. However, this concept or this tradition is at the verge of getting scrapped. Continuous and comprehensive evaluation acknowledges individual differences and insists on child's to grow his or her ability. It doesn't pressurize a child to perform in a particular area where his capability or her capability are limited. It also gives the opportunity to capitalize or to perform well in those areas where his abilities are strengthened to compensate in other areas. Thereby, it acknowledges individual differences and insists on child's to grow to his or her abilities. Continuous and comprehensive evaluation aims at evaluating all-round development of the students. Continuity refers to watching children's learning and progress regularly at short intervals as frequently as possible to identify their current standing, where they stand at present, their strength from where they can draw the compensation, and the requirements for further intervention. What are the dark spots which needs to be recovered? That's need continuity in observation to further expand their boundaries of learning. development and progress. As far as the comprehensiveness is referred to, comprehensive or comprehension means evaluation has to cover co-curricular subjects, co-curricular activities, socio-personal qualities and work, and art education, etc. It involves both quantitative and qualitative information gathered from various sources such as school records, peers, parents, teachers, and from the students on his own self through then use of varieties of tools and techniques. It means by using the variety of tools and techniques, we need to dig out the information or data from the all possible means about the particular learner or the student. Then there is a term of evaluation. In the whole term of continuous comprehensive evaluation, evaluation refers to recording of evidences indicating changes in different concepts of the performance of the students. Evaluation refers to the collection of evidences, processing of evidences which indicate change in the performance of a student to notice his or her progress. Now, what are the objectives of CCE? If we are talking about the tradition of continuous and comprehensive evaluation, we are required to invariably talk about the objectives of continuous and comprehensive evaluation in school system. When we talk about the objectives of continuous and comprehensive evaluation, continuous and comprehensive evaluation aims at making evaluation an integral part of teaching learning process. It also aims as using evaluation as a tool of children's learning. It also encourages self-learning and self-evaluation. It also aims at making sound judgments about and decisions regarding learners' growth, learning processes, learning pace, and learning activities. It aims at doing away with examination-related anxiety, fear, trauma, stress, or phobia from learners. It has distributed the point of evaluation. It is not doing evaluation at a fixed time. It is doing continuously. Thereby, it has removed all kind of fears and traumas associated with examination or assessment or evaluation earlier in the learners. Then it aims at strengthening the institution where the learning of students is taking place to evaluate at the place of external examinations. Now, what are the areas of assessment of continuous and comprehensive evaluation? As we have stated earlier also that this would be the main topic of this lesson. So now we are going to discuss that what are the areas indicated for the assessment of the learner under the scheme of continuous and comprehensive evaluation. As far as the continuous and comprehensive evaluation is considered, the assessment is done in the elementary classes in the four core areas. The first area is curricular area under which the assessment is done. Then the second area is of other curricular areas, and the third area is of socio-personal qualities, which are also called as in abbreviated form SPQs. Now we are taking each of the category one by one. When we talk about evaluation or assessment in curricular areas, curricular assessment in curricular areas include all the school subjects, languages, mathematics, journal science, social studies, etc. Then, evaluation in curricular areas also is consisted of evaluation which needs to be done continuously from the beginning of the academic session. Evaluation of curricular areas also accord the school authority to decide the periodicity of the assessment, preferably monthly, terminal in 3 to 4 months, and annual assessment, besides the continuous assessment which is going on routine basis and on day-to-day basis. Each assessment should cover the portion covered within that period, which is not to be repeated in the subsequent assessment. If a topic is taught between a period, the assessment should be made after the end of that period only, and that topic for the assessment purpose need not to be repeated in the consequent assessment. The purpose of assessment should be to reflect on the learning and on the progress of the student. Hence, assessment not to be in form of written test, examination, but through variety of tools. We are required not to be dependent on only examination, but required to use variety of tools such as oral tests, projects, assignments, class tasks, observation, preparation of models, reports. Different kind of techniques could be used to substantiate the performance scores which they accrue or score in the test or examination. Now, continuing the talks or discussion on evaluation in curricular areas, beside periodic assessment, daily basis assessment or the assessment on daily basis while teaching learning process goes on in a classroom or outside is also required and important, as it is on teaching or while learning assessment which helps in improving the teaching as well as the learning of the student. For this purpose, oral test, individual, group work, task and observation can be used by the teacher. Now moving on the assessment or the evaluation of other curricular area, which is the second area of assessment or under continuous and comprehensive evaluation. On the basis of nature of the subject and teaching learning process and practices, subjects like art education, health and physical education and work experiences, etc. are placed under a separate category, namely other curricular areas. These subjects provide more practical experiences and skills than theoretical knowledge. The learning and progress of students in these areas should be assessed mostly through observation in many occasions inside and outside the classroom, that is, while doing project work in the group, while performing tasks in the classroom, while interacting in a group or while learning collaboratively. Any time could be an potential time to assess the children. Here is a table which can be used as an example to identify that how learners are assessed in other curricular areas. In first column, we have exemplified the name of the activity. In second column, we can store information about whether adequate resources are available to perform that particular activity or not. In third column, we can also attain or have or record information about whether parents are supporting or not. And in the fourth column, we can keep the record of difficulties which we are facing or we have faced while conducting that particular activity or while conducting that particular task. Selection of multiple activities are required to assess other curricular areas or the performance of the students in other curricular areas. Under each category, provision of opportunities for participation as per the interest and choices are required. Thereby, the selection of multiple activities is required to give opportunity of choice to the students. Performance to be assessed through observation and award of grades. Marks cannot be awarded here when we are assessing or evaluating other curricular areas. Regular record of observation need to be kept on students' performance, and which facilitate the identification of child's caliber in the other curricular areas. Definite descriptors for grading of students' participation and performance needs to be developed by the teacher to avoid the ambiguity in assessment. Now coming on the socio-personal qualities. Socio-personal qualities such as cleanliness, punctuality, cooperation, respect, responsibilities, leadership, emotional stability, honesty, appreciation, etc. are also the important skills which are required to be there in a student to be considered as an holistic or developed personality. Socio-personal qualities nurtured and developed under the influence of peers, teachers, home environment and school environment. These are the potential sources or the context which affects the development of socio-personal qualities amongst the students. Socio-personal qualities are manifested in the context inside or outside the school premises. When a person or a student is interacting in any kind of context, whether in the school or out the school, with others, with other people, with other persons, with the peers, he or she is exemplifying or manifesting the socio-personal quality. Socio-personal qualities contribute to students' personality to make it holistic. Recognition of socio-personal qualities can be done by keeping regular notes of noteworthy event in which a student reacts, how a student behaves, etc., situation and activities indicative of these quality. Socio-personal qualities then awarded or graded to label the student's performance or behavior for a particular period. The school should decide periodicity of assessment of SPQs, preferably 3 to 4 times in an academic session. Here is an observation schedule on socio-personal quality in which there are different areas exemplified, such as cleanliness, truthfulness, cooperation, discipline, punctuality, emotional stability, environmental awareness, love and physical labor, respect towards superiors, appreciation, responsibility, leadership, honesty, so on and so forth. There are different kind of tools and techniques which can be used to assess the socio-personal qualities, such as observation, interview, checklist, profile, etc. The periodicity could be day-to-day observation by the teacher and 3 to 4 periodic assessment, and the reporting can be in the form of direct grading once in every 3 to 4 months. Now, to sum up, in this lesson, we have discussed about what assessment is, elaboration on why, when, where, and how of assessment have also been discussed. Continuous comprehensive evaluation has been discussed in details as innovative and holistic practice of assessment. Each of the area under which assessment should take place in CCE has been taken up in detail during the lesson. Now it's time to take home task and list the reasons for insistence on giving equal importance on assessment of students' performance in co-scholastic area. We will meet in the next lesson. By then, thank you. Thank you very much.